All right, Carl, we're ready.
Call the meeting to order. Public comment for the first thing we have.
Oh, is there, has there been any commission or zoning commission meetings yet?
Not that I know of, no.
Just wondering, because maybe they need reminding if they still have to post them.
I will be sure to remind them when I talk to them.
Sure they already know, just wanted to throw that out there.
Thank you, Carl.
That wasn't done yet.
Yeah.
Well, that wasn't question and answer, it was public comment. So if you're talking, you were asking. Tell him, Carl, yeah. Who does he think he is? My name is Robert Vogue, and I'm a citizen of the United States of America, also an Army veteran and a resident of Edgar County. There's been some discussion about zoning lately. I thought, since I'm not from Edgar County, and I was born and raised in an urbanized area that was zoned, and my family had woods and farmland, that maybe something I would say today would be helpful. At the moment, the zoning question seems to have arrived here in Edgar County because of the airport. And it's a requirement for expanding the airport. Thought to be an immediate need. Perception of the airport needs to be expanded. But the facts are, fuel sales are down when compared to several years previous. And air traffic is down when compared to years previous. And most communities here in Illinois that are struggling with the rising cost of government and decreasing revenue of government are now less willing to add additional airport operating costs or obligations to their already overwhelming financial burden. Edgar County may feel that way. They may feel like enough is enough, and the zoning question doesn't really need to be answered today. Even the land on which the airport is located is now has some concerns. But if you're considering zoning, you need to make no mistake. Zoning's not free. It will cost the county money, and it's money that you don't seem to have. You talk about zoning, and some people are in favor of spot zoning, and some people talk about countywide zoning. Well, the spot might be something on the shirt here, but when you think about spot zoning the airport, 2 mile radius around the perimeter of the airport's nearly a mile in length, better part of a mile in width, depending how you measure that, you're looking at 25 square miles of land that will probably wind up under a zoning if spot zoning for the airport is something you've got under consideration. But once you let the genie out of the bottle, you will probably find that you have countywide zoning. So one way or another, it's going to wind up, I think, being countywide zoning. Government never gets smaller. The thing to remember, if you're from this community, that it is an agricultural rural community. But the farmers are outnumbered, vastly outnumbered by the residents and those that are non-farmers in this community. What has happened in the past, in my experience, is similar to what we were talking about earlier. The farming community here, which is a rural farming community, maybe would think this is harmless and there's no long-term implications. But we mentioned earlier, before the meeting began, just a few of us were talking about reality. That's where you zone, and you zone an airport, and you wind up with countywide zoning, and then you zone for residential developments. And then you find the generational farm is adjacent to a new residential housing development. The next thing happens is the residents of that housing development or the new homes are saying, I don't like the hay being planted next to my bedroom window because I'm allergic to hay. So you talk about setback zones for hay because people have allergies. Then you wind up talking about setback zones for wheat. And you talk about setback zones. And then we were laughing about grass because people are allergic to grass. So you wouldn't want any turf farming out there in the country. Then you also have the other segment of the population that says, you know, I don't want to be smelling hog manure in the morning. There are people that make livings off of hogs. That smell is good to them. They like it because it's money, and that's what puts the food on the table. But there are people here, even some in this community today, given a choice, they would not allow livestock to be adjacent to residential properties. So I think what is happening here is that you're going to have non-farmers and those with non-farming interests making decisions over your property that you don't have to give up. You don't have to give up the authority for them to tell you what you can and can't do on your property. I think the longer you avoid that situation, the better off and the happier the community will be. There are processes and procedures. We have to hire zoning people to administer the zoning. We got to give them cars to drive around, to snoop around property. There's a lot to this, and today it doesn't look like much, but if you're thinking about zoning, this will be part of the picture. I think it would be wise just to defer the zoning until it's absolutely necessary. But that's my opinion. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay. We'll move on to committee reports. Andy, do you have anything?
Yeah, we got a air handling unit that's out in probation. And it's the one where they did took on past the law library and on past what used to be the what they call it, the computer room or something. And if you go on past that, where it's, I don't know why they put it where they put it, but it's, they kind of built a wooden structure and put this air handling unit up in between the drop ceiling and the old ceiling in there. And what's happened, you know where...
So it's not one of those sitting out on the porch?
Well, no, it's not. But that's going to have to be replaced also because the refrigerant, you no longer can use R22 refrigerant. So this is kind of what's... Anyway, the air handling unit itself is rusted out, and it was dripping. The water was dripping into the through the ceiling tile. So we pulled it out. They went up there. The unit's probably about 30 years old. Whenever they put that unit, redid the heating, air conditioning up there in the upstairs when that was put in. So you can no longer get the coil in the unit itself is also bad, but you can no longer get that size coil. Coils are now bigger than what they used to be. So basically you need to replace the system, and the unit on the outside is for R22 refrigerant, which can't be used anymore either. So I talked to Paris Refrigeration. I said, I don't want that thing put back up in the ceiling. Anytime you need to maintain it, you have to pull the ceiling tile out and get a ladder and climb up. And so and why they didn't do it to begin with, I don't know. It needs to be put up in the attic where you can get around it, service it, clean it, do whatever you need to do. It needs to have a pan put under it also. I've never seen one, well, at least one with air conditioning that didn't have a pan under it in case it leaked or something happened, and you have a secondary to catch the water before it leaks through your ceiling. But anyway, I think the thing to do is he's going to have to take that one out of there, put one up in the attic, and replace the, put a new unit outside, and put a new air handling unit up in the attic. And then I said, give me a price. He called, that's why I was late. He called me this morning. I talked to him. He said about $7,500, $8,000. And you have a new unit in there.
Where is it leaking at?
I wish I could.
In the probation office or
you know,
the courtroom?
You know where we did the renovation, or
where
the old law library kind of used to be along the back there?
Kind of right. There's one of the air handlers up
top.
Up there. Above that thing. There's one close to the door, and there's one on the far side.
This one was, you know where they cut the windows? The drop ceiling came and cut those windows right there. It was right above there. And that thing stretches out right along that hallway there. It stretches out probably 12, 14 feet.
So it's there by the head probation, chief probation officer's
new office now? Yeah, right in front of it.
Right. Okay.
You know how it's up the ceiling and then it comes down? Well, that's where they put it in there. I don't. They kind of hacked it in and put it in there. So you got to take that ceiling out and then drop that unit.
No warranty left on, I reckon.
No. Once it rusts.
So what's not getting air conditioning then?
That.
Just the new office?
The new office and that part back in there. That's, probation has its own. The actual old probation office has its own unit. So that's that area back in there. And then part of, I believe it's part of the, I don't know what you call it, where they put the bench, or the old bench where you stood. Uh-huh. Back in there is also heated and air conditioned by that.
So it's a heated central air conditioning unit for the whole upper floor of the courthouse.
For part of it. There are
a small
probably a quarter of it.
Yeah. Probably a quarter of it.
So central's a bit of a misnomer. It's like a two-room air conditioner, and it's a massive.
A zoned part. It's big.
Let's not use the C word if we can avoid it. Is there an opportunity instead of doing that, since it's kind of a strange hodgepodge there, what about those, if not necessarily a window unit, but like the...
split units?
You see them in like other countries and, you know, like in newer construction that are like...
That's what he's talking
the about.
What we talked about putting in
the courtroom. Yeah, putting in, they're called split units. Right. In other words, you have an air handler inside, which is small, usually they're right. Wall mounted, and then...
They're pretty efficient, I think, too. I don't know, I mean...
They are efficient.
It seems like...
They take a pretty good size. Those are... I'd love to look into doing those for some of the downstairs offices at some point, and get away with some of the window units. Mm-hmm. It's a big area upstairs. When I had them figure out how much area they'd be heating and cooling, and it would take, I mean, a normal one story, like 1,500 square foot house probably takes a 2 or 3 ton unit. This area that they're heating air conditioning takes a 5-ton unit up there. Okay. So it's a, even though it doesn't seem like it's that much area, it's a pretty good sized area.
So it's not just the back part where the old law library was and where we put in the new probation.
Yeah.
That's all it
that's
is?
That's that unit right there, that's that area.
And
right
that's
there.
The only thing it covers.
And that's really about the only thing
it covers. It doesn't cover any part of the courtroom?
No, the courtroom has
doesn't
two.
Cover
the courtroom old, has two units.
Right, and it doesn't really cover any of the, like, all the old probationary.
No, that has
just
two
that,
units.
Just that little area spot that we redid.
Yeah, just the part we redid.
A lot of money just for that little area. Big window unit.
Yeah, I don't know.
I mean, they're not efficient, but...
So I'm wondering if there isn't if there is anything more attached to it than that.
Can we repurpose that space? And like Jeff can use that to question all the guys he's got in the big house. You know, just really uncomfortable in there, hot or cold. And
I think that's where they end up after they talking to them if they're lucky.
Is this the air conditioning only? Or
heating and air conditioning. It's heating and air conditioning.
Of that vintage.
Ideally, what you want to do is have smaller zones anymore instead of larger. I mean, used to be you had one furnace for a whole house. Well, now what you ideally want to do is one for upstairs, one for downstairs. It's much more energy efficient. It's pay for itself all the time.
Not more in this room here. There's like two or three. Way more bigger than that. It goes clear back there from where the new place is. It goes 6 to 8 feet wide.
What's that?
When you go back to them, it's for a
five, maybe six on that wall, and it opens back up to another probably 10 feet wide.
Yeah, all the way back to where they used to have.
There's more space there than what, when you're sitting here thinking that's not very much, but there's more there when you get in and look at it.
More than this room here.
I was asking these guys, remember what those split units cost that we were talking about?
Probably about $8,000 to $12,000 for the split unit. For that size of it.
Oh, for that one. For that size. I was going to say, in the courtroom, I didn't think they were going to be that much.
I think when we ended up, it's going to take two heads. You run two heads off of one unit. I thought it was, that's going to be that kind of, yeah, it's going to be 8 or 10 or 12,000.
Wonder if we ought to get a second opinion or second prize.
We can. I don't mind doing it.
And maybe they might have a different option. I might not have just mentioned that.
Well, so there's a second unit upstairs. True.
There, total, there are
five or six.
There's five or six units.
So there's three on that side and
four? Is there four on that? There's three.
Three on both sides. Now, hell,
I can't remember how many. We replaced all but this one.
Yeah, I was just going to ask what state the other
one. The order put in last year was for the judges and
for the judges.
Party and the two judges.
Yeah.
But you're talking about there's two units in the courtroom.
Two units in the courtroom.
I wonder if they are big enough to hook.
I don't think so. Because they say, in fact, the thing is, you don't want to make those things too big, because then you want to size them just right so that they'll run. You don't want them to cycle too much, because if they cycle too much, you don't take enough moisture out of the air. They're really inefficient if they cycle too much. In other words, if it comes on and cools it real quick and then shuts off and then comes on real quick, you want it to run for a certain amount of time to take the moisture out of the pipes. And so you want to size those things just for the, when you do a house, they come in, they measure how tall your ceilings, how many windows you have. I know when I did my restaurant, they came in, and then there's a factor that you figure for how many people you think you're going to have in there, because people are like heat generators. Yes.
Absolutely. And we may not have a choice. I mean, we can't. That's one place where that is back there now. We're going to have some air, obviously.
Well, heat and air.
Yeah.
Does
that sound way out of line?
No, it doesn't to me at all. Not for. I mean, the problem is you've got to replace the outside unit, because you can't.
How much more is that going to? I mean, whatever it is going to cost.
Right. I'm sure. They're going to put it's a single phase unit out there now. They're going to put a three phase unit out there.
Yeah, I mean, basically, just like what they put on.
On the judge's side, right?
Yeah, that was the part that went out on the judge's side, right. Was the outside unit.
Right.
And the inside unit was still usable on their air handler. But this one didn't, you can't, they don't make those parts anymore.
For and we can't use that refrigerant anyway.
We can't use that refrigerant anyway. And the problem is they didn't get, I mean, normally you think, oh, probably got smaller. I mean, your computers all got smaller and smaller, but they actually got bigger. Your units got bigger.
Was it that one outfit going to bring a crane in to do it all, and we ended up not having to do that?
We did bring. He actually brought a crane in.
That's what cracked the concrete, wasn't it?
Well, that and the guys that came in and fixed the
roof
broke the concrete. So the crane.
It was a mutual cracking.
Was it?
I think they both cracked some of it. Actually, we did have to. I mean. Yeah, yeah, there was a crane
there
on
was.
The judge's side. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah, there was.
Was that Tom's unit? Tom came in with a crane?
I think so.
And lifted
because
that unit up.
Parish Refrigeration had to have somebody come in. Don't totally quote me on that. But
they paid. And that was on their dime that time.
Yeah, I don't know, but it wasn't just like you can't just put them up there. We
can't manually.
Yeah. Yeah. It'd take four or five farting boys. Okay.
Yeah, it's heavy, so that
it was because we had all that woodwork redone and everything before we put the new timbers underneath there.
Yeah, because the others, they put them flat ways and they were all bowed. So,
Andy, I just want to take you back on what they were talking about. So, could you not tap into part of the courtroom and part of the existing old probation, open that up some which way and bring them? Some duct work and be done with it?
I don't think you could.
You don't think that would work?
I mean,
it seems pretty simple, but then I'm sure it's not.
You know, this stuff.
And does probation have money for that? Or is that on us?
I don't think that would be necessarily there. Okay. I don't think, would it? That'd be hard.
Depending on how comfortable they want to be this one.
You know, like they should have been here to meet. That's it.
Fortunately, we're not doing anything today.
Yeah, they should have been here.
You know, you mentioned about the possibly coming off of two different areas. Maybe that's something that you ought to have someone
look at. I can have them look at it and see what they think. When they came back and said it would take a 5-ton unit, which that's a big, 5-ton's a pretty good size unit. Yeah. When they came back and said it would take a 5-ton for that area, and a lot of it's because of the ceiling height. And there's just more area there. I mean, you got the law library when you figure that in, and then
that's never used.
Well, that's courtroom four, right?
They do.
Three.
Well,
three, really.
Yeah, they.
No.
Those judges.
Oh, the law library. The law library. That little room. Okay.
That's call a part courtroom of three. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a part of it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's part of it too.
All right. I thought you were just talking about the probation officers, new probation officers' room only. Yeah. Okay. I'm with you.
That's more area. Probation part, the law library plus the old probation part.
I got it.
And then it actually swings a little bit, probably in behind that, where they keep some of their other archive stuff.
I understand.
Their law books.
Yeah. More likely, you're probably not going to come off as much area as you're talking if they're sized to where they're supposed to be.
You can't.
You're not going to be able to.
Because I said, figure out what size unit it'd take there, and he told me it'd take a 5-ton. That's a pretty good size unit.
Yeah.
So that's a pretty good size there. You got a lot of windows in there.
Right. All.
All that whole. Yeah. The whole around part.
Right.
So.
So you're thinking it's going to cost $75,000 to $80,000 for the unit, handler.
For the handler.
And then how much, or is that?
And then probably
another.
It's probably going to be around. Time you put the seating back in and things, because you're going to have to do some work in there. I mean, you've got to take that out to get that whole unit out. Yeah. You're probably looking at $9,000 or $10,000 for everything.
But that's not counting
the ceiling and everything. That's,
but that's not counting the other unit that's going to sit outside.
Yeah.
Oh, that is.
That's okay. Everything.
So that's going to replace what we have at up in the ceiling in. And also our outside unit,
yes.
For that.
He said he'd do that for 75. He said until I give him the okay, and he calls to see how much that. He's located 2 3-phase units, one's in Ohio and one someplace else. And you want 3-phase up there. I'm surprised that one that's up there isn't. But maybe about, he said $7,500 to $8,000 for all the heating air conditioning part, heat pump and everything.
And that's moving the air handler over into the attic.
Putting it, yep, going up, straight up top, going into the attic, okay. Getting out of that area that it's in now.
So that'd be off to the side of where the steps are going up to the,
yep,
on that flat area there.
Yep. Actually, you know where you go into the room where the chimney comes through upstairs?
Mm-hmm.
It's actually right over, over in that area there. In fact, there's some places you can look down through and see where
it's going to go.
Which kind of makes me wonder whether we should do some insulating or something up there at some point. But
I don't know. I don't think that's if that's the total to get that whole area back in operation again is like that $9,500 to $10,000. As big as that area is, and that's taking another thing out, that's putting a new handler in, that's putting a new
I don't
outside.
Think it's that bad.
Yeah. And that will just, and the other part of that is the actual, I can't think of the term now, the part that sits outside.
Compressor unit.
Yeah, thank you. That's going to sit outside.
That'll
right?
Sit up, yeah.
And so that other one over there is going to be gone also. He's going to put one in there.
That's more energy, a lot more.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So,
and
they're going to do all that stuff for, you think, around under $10,000 or around there.
And that's
replacing the ceiling. That would not be the Fanny doing that.
Have Mark Sullivan come in.
Someone else
evening.
Do that. Yeah.
But even that,
unless you think you could contact in a short time period someone else, get a quick bid to see. I mean, I realize it's kind of pressing if they don't have the air conditioning, right. But
if you want to get a second. I suppose I called Nicky, see if he wanted to give me an estimate. Last time I called those guys, they weren't very interested in. I guess they look at it like, oh, I'm going to do all this work, and you're not going to, you know, you're going to give it. I may get it, I may not.
If I get a lower price.
Yeah. No, I'll try them. I'll try.
I'd like to see maybe try to get another price just to see if we're getting the best bang for our buck.
Okay.
You know, if they can do it in the next few days, get you something.
Okay.
Because then whoever does it, then they got to order, you know, it takes time. Mm-hmm.
Right. That's what I was saying. I mean, I don't know if you'd want to go out forever, you know, on this. I mean, because that's the type of thing where you have people that are being serviced up there. And
does Dick do, last couple of times, he still does it, doesn't he?
Who's that?
Dick Walker.
Yeah, they've done some of the work up there.
Okay.
On the machine, the units there, well, the 911 units, they've worked on them, I know.
Okay. Lately?
Yes.
Okay.
Last year.
Yeah.
Okay, last year. Yeah. I called him once and he didn't seem to. He'd be like, I don't know if I'm interested in doing that. And I'm like, okay. But I called. I had White come in and do something. I think he came and gave me an estimate too on something once. So yeah. I'll call around.
Give them and see if they can get you a quick
estimate on it.
Yeah. And I'd say, you know, if whatever the lowest price is, get it done. I mean, it's got to get done.
I don't know what else to do. They've taken the ceiling out now to kind of, because a lot of the tile was, well, it got ruined when that little pan just, it all rusted out and started ripping all over.
Anything else?
That's it, I think.
Plenty in there.
Jerry?
So I talked to Chris, I can't remember his last name, that works for the, crop dusting operation that wants to rent the hangar space, and told them, you know, that we'll have something for them by 1 July and be ready to go on that. My question is, do we need to follow any kind of protocol? I kind of talked over as far as, you know, he needs some sort of airtight legal document to put in front of him as far as this goes, or, you know, we'd be happy with, we'll hit the high points on the document and whatever works, you know. So
something similar to like what we had with Mills.
Well, that Mills document is rather
right
elaborate.
Yeah, because that involves. Yeah.
I mean, this is a 1-year deal, so.
Well, we don't want a T hanger lease document either.
What's that?
A T hanger document lease.
No.
Something where in between.
Yeah, and I told them, you know, as far as their only requirement, we'd need a copy of their, you know, insurance.
Right.
For that one. And then just to say we'd start it, you know, July 1 as far as the first day of, you know, getting a check from them. But yeah, having no experience of drawing up hangar leases, I was just curious on the table.
I know Voight was involved in the other one. I think some of that information came from a lease from somebody else of some sort. Yeah, I
imagine Google would be a source for something like that, but I didn't know how deep into the weeds we needed to jump on that, so I'm just gonna bounce that off my elders, see what y'all thought. But second piece would be, do we want to establish a deadline to pass to the zoning commission on when we would like their initial report to us, or just see what organically grows from their efforts?
Well, they need to start working on some stuff, gathering information, the necessary information that we need to put in that.
I would
regulations.
You think we could get? Is it reasonable to ask to have an initial report to us prior to our study session, first study session in August, prior to the board meeting?
I would think that would
That's
be
better
the
than a month. To
I don't. There's no way they can do it in July. I mean, I'm guessing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As far as I know, they haven't done anything. So
I know I talked to Tom, and he was going to look into some other information, getting some information. I talked to one of the board commission members Saturday, and told him that Tom was working on that and they need to get together at some point in time. I'll check with this week to see what Tom come up with. I talked to him last week and see if he's come up with anything on some information I gave him.
I don't think that'd be a bad idea, though. If we could get them even just like a little feedback by that study session in August, like, you know, kind of like where they're at, because it may be, hey, we've tried this, and we can't find this, or this is a good idea.
Sure. Well,
is that what you're saying, maybe? Yeah. By the study session in August, kind of give us some feedback on where we're at?
If we put a stake in the ground for that August date, for the initial report, which there is no, as far as I know, there is no gold standard as far as what that initial report should look like.
Right.
I would say if they give us feedback during or before any of our three meetings in July, we can always extend. But that's what I'd like to do. And like I said, I think kind of what I envision that initial report is, you know, opening paragraph and then say that the zoning should include the following things, and basically take the federal and state statutes that we're using now and bullet point them out, hand to us, and we'll say, okay, yay or nay, or this wasn't in there, why do you put this, and, you know, as our initial report, and then we can schedule the public hearing and then move on from there. So I can pass that to those two commission members and get that going. So that's the consensus for everybody's happy with that.
August 8th. I mean, that's the study session type, what I'm saying. The board meeting was on the 10th. So is that what you're looking at?
Yeah. I know one of the commission members is getting married here in a week or so. So got to allow for his honeymoon and all that. So maybe we can work on it on it.
Okay.
Uh-huh. Babe just wants to knock this thing out. That's all I got.
Okay. Mr. Zuber.
All I have is just a reminder that I think we talked about in our July meeting for our insurance consultants, Bushu contract. Actually, comes up September 1. It is all one package, so to speak. They advertised that they would still do basically another 3 years if that's what we wanted. And I think that's what they're looking at. It's roughly $9,500, $10,000 per year. So we just have to make a determination on that. Talk a little bit with Andy about it. Talk a little bit with Mike about it. Talk to some of the rest of you. But bottom line is, I wanted to bring it up again today. Okay, so was there any other questions about that? I think you probably, I say you, probably won't pertain to me as much anymore, but I think one of the big advantages that they do hold, though, is that one, it kind of keeps everything kind of in double check with whoever get the different bids from people, and two, I don't know who's going to be able to keep track of the Affordable Care Act and all the different qualifications, stipulations that go up. I think our county workers are... have enough on their plates, as Liz and I talk a lot with Terry. You know, she's our insurance person now, and she does a lot of stuff. I think in talking to her, she's also seems like she has a very good working relationship with them. If she said anything to you, I'll get out, but that's what she told me. You know, so you know, she seems like that's a good crew to work with. No matter what's going to happen in the election, one way or the other, you're either going to have things that are going to be changed, or things that are added to, or things that are taken away. I'm not sure that, again, in all fairness to like Gary or whoever else, that you can keep track of all that stuff. So, and that's what, I just wanted to bring it up again, because I'd really like to get that squared away in July, what we're gonna do, because that is a September 1, I believe, renewal.
That's with Bush.
With Bush. Okay. Right. And I don't think that's a bad cost. I'm not sure we can pay anybody that little amount or that. I know that's real money, but that amount of money to take care of that stuff. And I don't know that we're really looking to add employees and do that type of issue. Anyway, I'll let that ride. And if anybody has questions or now. But I know when we were all here the last time and at the last meeting, I tried to bring it up like a couple different study sessions at the last board meeting, and I'll bring it up again then. Study session right before July board meeting, but I think we've already scheduled to put that on the agenda for a possible board action in July, in and out. And that's all I have right now.
Where are we at on the health insurance there? Put the ads in the paper?
Right.
Bidding that out?
I'd be glad to comment if I could on that.
Go ahead.
The bid notice did go out in the Prairie Press. I'd also submitted a request to the former Beacon News, and but it never ran, and I never saw it. And when I went to check on it, that was the time that the merger, if you will, occurred. And a couple of the gals went over to the Beacon, looked at some old newspapers, not in there. They just didn't reply back to me. So it did not get into Beacon News, and that Bushu has their timetable, their time frame listed, and it got in the Prairie Press. It did not get into Beacon. Yeah. So if one time's enough, then it is. If it's not, we'll run it again.
You didn't pay for it, did you, for the Beacon?
It didn't run. No, I didn't pay for anything.
Make sure.
No, I think we're all right there, because you know they have those rough times, and there's again another thing that they kind of do is give us a listing of when everything's supposed to be, so you can have the checklist. And I think actually within that framework, we will have hit more people on that one notice than we would have probably.
Oh, I agree.
In news.
I agree.
So
I agree.
I think we're okay on that.
So I'm going to check with Carrie
at
Bushu and just let her know what happened and let her know we did fulfill that requirement. And if once is good enough, then it's good enough.
Yeah,
so that's where we are with that.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
And when's our health insurance expire? Is it October 1st?
September 30th.
Yeah, because what that does is by us getting this stuff out, we get that full month. I just talked with Terry about that too. You get the full month of people to hopefully make some determination where we are. And I think I'm not sure if I mentioned that. I think we had five plans last time, and we just decided to go ahead with those five plans. Even though we had one plan that absolutely nobody used or that was interested, I told them, go ahead and keep that in there, because who knows, in 1 year's time, people's lives change.
Everything.
And different things changes. So that may appeal to somebody. I talked to Bushu also. I said, we just have to make sure that when those people bid, they make sure that they put in a bid for at least a program that is currently acceptable by Affordable Care Act. You know, you can have all the bells and whistles you want, but you at least have to have one that meets all those requirements that Travis talked about that day, that basically is not the Cadillac, but it's one that if people still want their health insurance through us, then they can still do it.
So a lot of the plans are going to be similar to what we currently have.
They should be. The bid part is going to be all the same that we have. You know, but sometimes when we had this bid, and as we talked about many times now, is that it's just harder and harder to get anybody to bid. I mean, like Blue Cross basically bids, and that's one of the reasons also brought up that maybe sometime in the future, you may want to look at the self-assurance and go with what other counties throughout the state have done to see if that's a viable option for us. And it's a risk type of thing, but there's some other counties, several of them in fact, that are having some good success with it. And it's the same group that oversees a different part of our property and casualty and also our workman's comp, so, which we've had, I think, good success for that organization too. So,
okay. Sheriff?
I don't have anything right now.
Okay. I know I talked to Jeff, the chairman, Jeff Boyd, the chairman, the other day about the sheriff's deputy's contract that we approved here, 6 months ago or whatever. And in that, we have a labor, I don't know what that group was. You're going to have.
Well, we have a meeting every 3 or 4 months.
Every 3 or 4 months,
right,
to talk about the main issues was the overtime issue and the insurance issue, and that was one of the reasons I was asking about what the new health insurance might look like. And I talked to a deputy the other day on the overtime issues. So I told him after this month is complete, we'll have 2 months documented with the new overtime issues and procedures. And sometime next month, we'll
get together
so we can
discuss,
you know, with you, one or two members of the county board, and one or two or ever how many they want from their side to discuss and see how things are going from both perspectives, and see if there's anything that could be changed. Just keep everybody updated and see how things are going. So once this month is completed and we get the payroll records for the whole month of June, because I've already got the ones for May.
Okay.
And we'll sit down and talk about it and see what we go from there.
So, I think it's probably a good time to do it again, because I think, we talked about it earlier, this last couple of months have been probably exceptional months for having to call guys in.
Mm-hmm.
Different emergency situations, so that's going to kind of,
right.
It's not a regular couple months payroll this time.
So. Right. Well, the first part of May was pretty good.
But
then the last month of May, or the last part of May, wasn't so good, and this first 2 weeks hasn't been good. There's been a lot of overtime and not a whole lot of part-time, so we'll sit down and look at it and talk about it and go from there. So, anybody have anything else?
One thing that popped in my mind, I believe I sent out to everybody the dismissal for MR-61. You guys got that? Okay.
Yes.
I think that's all I have. I was going to mention the health insurance, so you got that. Okay. I'm good, I think.
Yeah, if there's nothing further, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right. Opposed, same time, we're adjourned.
This is wild.